Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, small robot up there. Hi, welcome to On the Verge. I'm Josh Topolsky, editor-in-chief of The Verge, and we're very happy to have you here. Very, very pleased. We have an amazing show, a delightful show, a delectable, fantastic, terrific show. I've been playing with a thesaurus lately, so. We have some amazing guests. Tony Fadell is here. He's one of the men who was behind the iPod, the iPhone, and now he is the CEO of Nest, the thermostat, which you may have heard about, or maybe not, but you're going to hear about it tonight, damn it, and you're going to like it. He's going to be out here. He's a fascinating dude. Chris Grant is here, who is the editor-in-chief of Polygon, and he's going to talk games. There may be even some gaming here. Could be exciting or horrible. Go either way. And we have music from Animal Style, which sounds either dirty or delicious if you know what In-N-Out Burger is. Also, that sounds kind of dirty, too. You know what? Let's just say that Animal Style is here to play music and leave it at that. And we have a bunch of news. Neil Ian Paul are here. We've got some videos, some announcements, some giveaways. And we're very excited to have you guys along for the ride. I want to thank Motorola, who's our sponsor for tonight's show. They've given us delicious money. And some giveaways, actually. So I think we should probably just get this thing started. So let's do it. Yes. Hi. Hello. Now I'm over here. I'll be announcing my movements all night. Just so you're sure where I am. So before we get started, I actually want to talk about something. So the last time we did the show, a bunch of people were asking about, I have an iPad here on a dock, and people were like, he's not even using the iPad. Like, why is that there? Got a lot of angry emails, a lot of angry, bitter emails about the fact that during the interview, I wasn't leaning over to type something. But so actually, in between segments and stuff, I'm talking to the control room, which is back there, and saying things like, hey, this is horrible. Why did I say that? My lighting's bad. Is my face melting? That sort of stuff, which is what's going through my head all the time when I'm out here. But interesting side note, so Motorola sent us. So anyhow, so I'm talking to people back there on this. I do use it, I swear. I swear to you. But Motorola sent us some Razer Maxes to give away tonight. And the internet here is really bad. And so we actually had to open them, and back there, they're using it as a hotspot to communicate with me, which is a testament, I think, to Verizon's LTE service. I'm not plugging, it is quite good, but also a testament to how horrible the internet is here, and that's odd, because this is a school. So I think we should be concerned about what's happening to the youth in regards to internet. Anyhow, we have a lot of news to get to and not a lot of time. So please welcome my good, good, good friends, Paul Miller and Neil Ian Paul. Yes. So good to see you.
Thank you for coming.
Always a pleasure. Always a pleasure.
Good stuff. My old seat.
Yeah.
God, I feel so much more comfortable here.
Look at this.
We got
water. Isn't this fancy? Yes, to you.
I have water as well.
Mm. Cheers, guys.
You know what would be amazing? It would be amazing if I was being poisoned by this beverage right now. I mean, it wouldn't be amazing for me, obviously.
But great entertainment.
It would be fantastic video entertainment.
Maybe
for
we'll
people.
Do that. The audience would super react to it like it was new.
Yes.
like a new joke.
We'll just edit that out. Anyhow, so you dress like a hitman tonight. Can you tell me?
I poisoned you.
Oh, there you have it. Now it all makes sense. Anyhow, you know Paul Miller and Neil Ian Paul. They are good buddies, editors. And we actually wanted to start with some news. Paul Miller has some news. Before we get into news, Paul Miller has internal news.
That's gross.
Special news. He's getting surgery. No, Paul is, I'm gonna try to explain this, then I'm gonna ask you some questions. I'm gonna try to explain it as best I can. Paul is leaving the internet for a year. Mm-hmm. He's going to continue to write for The Verge, continue to do the podcast, do the show. He's going to file. Explain what you're doing. I'm not going to say. I want you to explain what
I'm
you're
doing. I'm leaving the internet for a year. I'm going to stop using the internet directly. And it won't be on my phone or my computer or my tablet.
So hold on. No web stuff.
No web stuff.
No web pages.
No Reddit.
No, obviously that's a web page. on the internet.
Are you going to download all of Wikipedia to a flash drive?
I'm going to avoid hyperlinks. So I will download some. I've been actually downloading a lot of things this week, but I won't download archives that include hyperlinks.
No chatting?
Nope.
Text messaging?
I'm going to avoid text messaging, too.
That's not on the internet.
I know, it's just a distraction.
No online gaming.
No streaming services,
no Netflix, no...
No Netflix, and I'm also not going to ask people to use the internet for me. I don't want to directly benefit...
You don't
benefit.
Have, like, that guy who, like, uses the elevator for
you?
That's an elevator guy. So you're talking about, like, an elevator attendant?
Yeah.
Not just like a guy that Paul travels with.
Yeah.
Paul Miller's private elevator.
You want to have a butler, is what you're saying. An internet butler.
I might have a butler, but I won't ask him to use the internet.
Internet butler? Kind of an amazing idea.
No, that's a failed 90s bubble
Jeeves.
Startup.
Yeah. You can call him Jeeves. You can ask him a question.
Ask Jeeves.
And at some point, maybe just shorten it to ask.
What's your goal with all
this? Yeah, so explain, because so you've been, when you came to me with this crazy plan.
Crying.
You were like, I want to write about, you've been on the internet for a super long time, most of your adult life.
Right.
And you want to write, he wants to write about like what his life is like without the internet in it.
Yeah, the internet fills most of my life and has filled most of my life and, since I was a teenager. And so I don't really know what it's like to be an adult or be in civilization without the internet. So I just want to find out what that's like. And I think I have an interesting perspective on it because I'm part of Generation Twitter. I'm young enough that I don't really remember life before.
Well, you don't like the terminology that I coined? You don't like my description of our generation?
Yeah, every day I wake up and I think I have my dream job, and then you say Generation Twitter, and I think to myself I need to be a carpenter or just something where that isn't real.
That's what I'm here for.
Yeah. Driving me to carpentry.
So Paul actually did a video explaining kind of what he's doing and his thinking behind it, and
sort of preparing
and what he's doing to prepare for it, and it's quite interesting. So take a look at this.
Hello, my name is Paul Miller, and I'm leaving the internet. I've been on the internet for the majority of hours of my waking life. I go to sleep with the internet, I wake up to the internet, and it's kind of invaded my life. It's supposed to be like a utility, right? Like the sewer. And you don't go down into the sewer. It just helps you. It's a helper. If you go down into the sewer of the internet, I mean, after a while, you start to feel dirty. CSS, crappy, stupid superhighway. HTTP, had that, thanks, please, /. HTML, how this, my life will be different. So I'm gonna have my phone, I'm gonna have an iPad, I'm gonna have a computer, but they're not gonna be connected to the internet. I'm not even gonna text message because I wanna be in the zone. And I don't know how long it's gonna be. Could be forever, could be for like 3 hours. I might just freak out. But I'm gonna do it, and before I go, there's some things I need to do. So here I am at the library. I've been trying to think of a good way to replace Wikipedia. It's one of my favorite websites. So I've been reading a lot of Yelp reviews about libraries, and I picked this one, 4 out of 5 stars, pretty good. The only complaint was that there's a lot of children here. I feel like that's complaining that there's sick people at a hospital. This is a place for learning, it's a place for joy. So what if a kid gets excited about Curious George once in a while? You know, there's some stuff on here that I'm gonna really miss, and I think the biggest thing is gifts. I just love gifts so much. When I'm lonely or I miss being connected to, the information super high out corgis, you know what? I'm gonna save it.
Here you go, Mr. Miller.
Thank you very much. These are my thumb drives. This is what I will use to form a sneaker net to transfer information to my peers and colleagues What I use the internet for a lot now is looking up health things. You know, if I have a rash or maybe it's cancer. You know, it's usually cancer.
So I'm here at Canal Street, the world capital of fake watches, fake t-shirts. You can get fake electronics, but I'm on the hunt for a genuine old school Nokia. Do you have any old Nokias?
Old Nokia? No.
Yeah, no? No? Like, what's the oldest phone you got? Like a real old, like a Nokia or something? Cool. What brand
is it? Psychic? How about Psychic? That's used though, super used.
Whoa, dude. Wow. I want to like play Snake on it.
No, I don't have it. I know, that was the coolest game ever.
It's the coolest game. Let's see, phones. Can I see the Nokia over here, the C102? Cool, games. No games. So you might think that Spotify invented free, unlimited music, but actually, there's been music at the library all along. A little bit of Dashboard Confessional. Yeah, we got a little bit of Dave Matthews. Oh, we got Fritz. If you want to shuffle your music. What? No old phones? All right, thank you. So, struck out. Apparently they only have new fake phones on Canal Street. I'm a little disappointed, a little disillusioned. But I think you know what I have to do now. All right, this is the last time I'm just gonna use eBay because you know what, it's easier. And there you go. I bought a phone just now, and I spent 3 hours trying to do that at Canal Street. So one of my favorite things to do on the internet is play StarCraft II, and StarCraft II doesn't really work without the internet. So I'm gonna see if I can find a replacement. What would be some good like things to get me started if I just wanted like a...
For playing, you mean?
Yeah, if I was just gonna have a really bare bones... The rules.
Yeah, because how are you gonna play without those?
It's true. This is kind of like playing StarCraft against Warcraft. I think this is gonna be a good move for me. So ultimately, I have no idea what life is gonna be like without the internet. I mean, you can prepare for these sort of things, these sort of natural, personal disasters. You never really know how you're gonna react until it happens. In the grim darkness of the far future, mankind teeters on the brink of extinction. There's no time for peace, no respite, no forgiveness. There's only war. Although I guess in my case, it's more like there is no internet. It's not like personally like a war thing for, it's just like, I can't get on the internet at all. But you know, it's basically the same thing.
Yeah.
I will say this. In rehearsal, we were like, we're gonna end this and we have to come back. It's gonna be a sad moment.
Very sad.
I'm like full of joy.
I'm excited.
I want you to quit the internet so bad.
Yeah, I just wanna know, I wanna see, you. I wanna live through your eyes and words.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I wanna see what it's like. So Paul is gonna be-
You're gonna be like my dad.
Yeah.
Cause he never.
No, but your dad has an iPad and stuff.
He has my mom.
Your dad accesses the internet, okay? Paul, no internet.
Don't talk about my dad.
So hold on. Let me. I know what your dad's up to. So Paul's gonna keep doing stuff for the site. Keep working. Coming. You'll be in the office a lot more, won't you?
Yeah. Because
you're not gonna be able to just here's an email.
Are you gonna get more sleep?
I hope so. And but it might be just late night Warhammer.
I want to play Warhammer.
We should play Warhammer.
I'm excited about that. And you're gonna file like journals on the site.
Yep.
Like, you know, postcards from the edge.
Yes, basically. I'm very excited.
I don't know what that is, but.
I actually wanted you to ceremoniously, is that how you say it?
Ceremoniously.
You're going to learn how to pronounce so many words.
You're going to get a dictionary.
That dictionary. You're not going to have the button
that tells you how it's pronounced, which
that's
is going to be difficult.
Yeah. I'll have to have a person, my butler, stand next to me and sound out the words.
You want to create a ceremonial moment.
Yes. Yeah. In the ceremonial moment, I would like you to put my iPad on airplane mode.
Me?
Yes. Yeah. I mean, I'm not leaving the internet until May 1st.
So May 1st
it's
is
totally
the day.
Symbolic. As soon as we get back
and
there,
I should say,
Monday night, we're going to have Paul will be on the internet as much as possible.
Yeah.
Do we have a sound effect for this? I should do a sound effect, right?
Please.
All right, hold on. But Monday night, okay, you got that?
I'm trying to get as much internet in. A year's worth of internet.
On Monday night,
week, before
you go off the internet, you're going to be on Turntable FM.
Yep.
In Minecraft, in StarCraft.
Streaming live,
yep. And also you're going to do a IAMA on Reddit.
Yep.
These are my last 2 hours on the internet.
And we're going to live stream all of that.
And we're going to live stream all of that on the site.
I don't know if we'll do that.
Send me your gifts. But you're going to turn this back on, aren't you?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
We'll just pretend this is the final moment, okay? Yeah. And it's going to have a sound effect. Did that work? I think that worked. Here you go.
Effective.
Welcome to No Internet.
Yeah. I'm sorry.
I feel like I'm knighting you. All right, we have other news to talk about. But anyhow, Paul Miller is leaving the internet, not leaving The Verge, as people speculated on the site. They're like, the last time you had an announcement, Joanna left.
Yeah.
Paul is not going anywhere. He's actually contractually obligated to not ever go anywhere.
That's right.
So
once Joanna left, we locked Paul down.
That's right. You're like, just sign here in blood. We cut him and made him sign in blood.
It was really weird. I was like, what? You don't want to let me read the contract? It was kind of...
We were holding, Neil, I was holding him down, and I was like moving his hand.
But it's still legally binding.
Yeah. Still legally binding, yeah.
Completely normal.
Okay, so there's other news we want to talk about. So there's this watch on Kickstarter. I don't know if you've seen it. It's the Pebble Watch.
Yeah.
Do you know what this is? It's a Kickstarter project. So their original goal, they needed $100,000. What it is, it's a smartwatch that interfaces with iOS or Android. Control your music player, tell you the time, you get text messages on there,
it's the smartwatch that every company has been trying to make forever.
And that's actually a bit of my confusion. Like, what really sets this apart from, because there's so many people have tried.
Well, it doesn't look like crap.
It doesn't look like crap.
I think that's a big piece for people. Second, it has an e-ink display. The battery lasts for a long time. It's like 4 or 5 days.
And it's also it's a hardware startup. It's cool. It's not like...
No, I don't think it's that. I think it's that it works with the iPhone. I think that's it. I think that's where people
are excited. Well, I don't pay you to think. Actually, I do. Actually, it's like your main thing is thinking.
Yeah. I just sit all day.
I got it. But I do think there is something to the grassroots sort of...
Well, I mean, but these guys, they already made one watch, right? They made the Impulse watch, which we reviewed, actually.
But not funded on Kickstarter.
Not funded on Kickstarter.
Okay. I'm glad it's working out for them. I really want this to be reality. I don't want to be teased again.
So I just want to note here. $100,000 was their goal.
Yep.
And $6.8 million has been pledged, which means that they hit their goal, and people are like, I want to keep giving them money. They got what they needed, but
they want the watch, because if you pledge $100, you get the watch.
Everybody wants the watch.
Yeah.
But we were thinking about it, and we realized there are a lot of projects on Kickstarter that are important, that need funding, that haven't hit their goal. And if you're thinking about spending more money on the Pebble watch, maybe you could, you know,
There's only so much money in the world.
Right. It's finite. And
it's
going to
zero
run out.
Sum.
Yeah.
It's going to run out, and then what are we going to do?
We're all going to buy. System. We're going to have great watches, but nothing else.
But no clothes. Nude with a watch. Is that what you want? Anyhow, so we found some other projects that we think are, you know, important and need funding. We'd like to share them with you. The first one is this. It's bow ties made of different materials. This one is made of guitar picks. They have them made of Legos, made out of corks.
Yeah.
I want this.
There's one made out of film, old film.
Yeah.
There's also a bow tie made out of QR codes, and I don't know how that works.
This is important because I think the bow tie industry has been, you know, lacking in a diversity of materials.
They're a disruptive bow tie startup.
Disruptive. Yeah, absolutely. This is a disruption in the bow tie industry.
I like that they have three backers who pledge $40.
And I feel like this would go great with your watch, too.
This and your nudity.
Yeah.
Bow tie, guitar bow pick, tie, bow tie.
E-ink watch.
E-ink watch.
Nothing nude. Else.
Maybe a pair of sandals.
But for $40, you receive an invitation to bow tie launch events in Connecticut and New York City.
Mm. Mm. So anyhow, really they only have $1,600. They need $15,000. Don't you want... All right, let's move on to the next one. You don't want to... this is Fiddlesticks.
Fiddle/Sticks.
Fiddle/Sticks. Now, Fiddlesticks is... I don't know if it's a man or that's the name of the project, but this guy plays the fiddle. And he wants... By the way, this is real. I'm not making this up. This is not like a gag.
By the way, you know what the worst thing you can do for your faith in like the American economy is? Is troll Kickstarter.
Just search Kickstarter
just
for
look
stuff.
At what people want.
Okay, so he wants to jam with drummers, different drummers of different musical backgrounds. And he wants to videotape it and record it. So fiddle jams, okay?
All different genres.
All
right?
Different genres.
He doesn't want to like limit himself
and,
to one
and
genre.
He just needs $15,000 to jam.
I just wonder how did people jam before Kickstarter is what I want to know.
They couldn't. Yeah. They wouldn't. Anyhow, so he's only got $655, and he desperately needs your money.
Zero people have given him $5.
Probably for rent, I'm guessing, and maybe...
Nobody wants a special Fiddlesticks thing.
Could be late-night sandwiches as well that money's going to go to. So, at any rate, I hope it's to see a lot of fish-style jam bands rise up out of the Kickstarter world. So finally, and this is my favorite one, this is a project to build a holodeck.
Yeah,
I saw this. I actually got a PR email about this, and I was like, "Holy shit, I want a holodeck."
Yeah,
who doesn't want to be on the holodeck, have their own in their house?
Everybody.
And so, take a look at the video. See if you notice.
Video is amazing.
See if you notice anything strange about this project.
Hi, Kickstarter. My name is Joel Payne, and I've been working in the entertainment industry as a digital artist for 20 years now. Throughout my career, one TV show has stood out in my mind: Star Trek. It's been the inspiration for lots of amazing real-world technologies. But there was this one Star Trek technology I really wanted to be a reality. The holodeck. So imagine, you're Skyping with your friends, and I could replace the room behind you with a fantastic 3D world, like something you'd see in a Pixar movie. If you're a little girl, I could give you pixie wings. I could give you the ultimate futuristic high-end office, complete with droid.
Greetings, Earthling.
What I need the funding for is to pay for the software that will project these 3D worlds around you. It'll take us $150,000 and about 8 months to finish the software. If we manage to raise more than $150,000, then I'll announce a very exciting second tier of the technology that could redefine the way we tell stories between us. So can you help me help you fulfill your wishes? In a month's time, I'd like to say these words to you. Wish granted.
I'm not sure he understands how the holodeck works. The holodeck is a room you walk into, and it becomes some other place. He's describing the iChat effect where you have the roller coaster in the background.
Yeah, I'm concerned he's never heard of iChat.
Yeah, do you worry that the droid called him Earthling?
It is a little weird.
Like,
where did it come from? Was it not made by humans? It's an alien droid? I mean, that's the least of our problems here.
But I'm worried that you can't get the pixie wings if you're not a girl.
That is a little lame. Speaking for me, of course. Anyhow, they need $150,000. and they only have $2,500. Won't you help them build the holodeck? Anyhow, that's Kickstarter stuff. There's a few things we wanted you to think about and look at. So if you're going to pledge money to Pebble, maybe consider helping to build a holodeck.
If you want a watch, maybe don't get a watch. Get a guitar pick bow tie.
Guitar pick bow tie.
That's our pitch to you.
Think about what a wonderful, you got Fiddlesticks in the background. Got your watch on. Fiddlesticks is superimposed over, or maybe Fiddlesticks will have his own holodeck like room.
Well, each different holodeck has a different song from a different genre.
Yeah. Yes. Right. Anyhow, you're in
we
the okay. We should move on. All right. So the last thing I want to talk about is Instagram. Maybe you've heard of it. It's a hot new service that everybody's using. It is a photo sharing, photo snapping, photo manipulating. Oh, you know what Instagram
photo
is.
Photo ruining.
Why am I describing it to you? So Instagram was purchased by Facebook for $1 billion, $1,000 million.
Mm-hmm.
Is that right?
Sure. Yeah.
I like to say it that way. It sounds more impressive, doesn't it?
And everybody was very happy.
Everybody's very excited, except your sister.
Yeah. My sister actually quit Instagram the moment they got bought by Facebook, which is very...
I don't understand. Did anybody here quit Instagram when it was purchased by Facebook? besides Paul's sister, who may or may not be in the audience. So nobody here did that, but I've heard other people, they're like, I'm out of here, screw this.
Yeah,
it's destroyed.
I just said to her, it's like, you know, Facebook could very well destroy Instagram. They could drop .io it and just murder everybody.
It is.
But they haven't done anything yet, so just quit it once it gets bad.
Yeah, I don't really get it at all.
No, you know, Mark Zuckerberg, the six guys at Instagram, he released them into a forest.
Right.
Now he's hunting them.
Yes.
I don't think.
I like this.
Are you saying he's like a cannibal?
He only eats what he kills.
But that's what I'm saying. He's chasing the Instagram. I don't know where this scenario came from in your mind.
Anyhow, I cannot confirm or deny.
So, okay, I mean,
look, there's a lot of creepy pictures of the woods coming from the Instagram founders. That's all I'm saying.
I don't know what you're talking about. But I do want to say, so we actually have like a little bit of news tonight about Instagram that nobody...
A little bit of a scoop.
Big scoop.
Yeah, it's actually kind of crazy. So you know that Instagram is staying its own business. They're going to continue to make the app. They have this money. Facebook isn't going to like screw up. They say they're not going to screw up what they're doing. And we discovered that they are actually investing some of that money in hardware. They're making an Instagram hardware product. And we got a leak of a video, a promo video for this product. And we're going to show it. We're going to show it now. Nobody's ever seen it before. And actually, when we come back, Tony Fadell is going to be here. But I want you to watch this video. You guys are the first ever to see it. This is Instagram's new hardware project.
With 40 million users, it's obvious that people love Instagram. But how are you supposed to share your photos with the 6.95 billion people that aren't on Instagram? Introducing Instagram Snap, a new way to create and share your photos IRL. Instagram Snap gives you all the functionality you've come to know and love. Share with your friends, personalize your pictures, and combine real-world materials to create filters. Classic, dashboard, sun flare, coffee, early bird, rustic, toaster, and cokehead. Instagram Snap, it's what we did with $1 billion.
And all right. I actually have the Instagram Snap prototype right here. It's pretty advanced, and I have to say it does make sharing extremely handy. In fact, I'm going to take a picture of you guys, and then I'd like you to pass it around to see what it looks like. So smile. Are you smiling? Smile, damn it. All right, that'll just take 4 minutes to develop. Anyhow, our first guest is an awesome dude, incredibly smart, really good looking, and has, I think, some very interesting stories to tell. So please welcome Tony Fadell. Yes. Yes, it was a hardware competition there. How are you?
Great.
Have a seat. We got you some water.
Whoa, we gotta watch out
not
here.
Not poison. That's broken. This is our thing. We keep saying we're gonna replace it, but it's more fun to just leave it. And also way cheaper. Anyhow, Tony, thank you for joining us. You're a fascinating dude. You've done a lot. You're doing more stuff. And I want to talk about some of it here. So
I didn't do as much before the internet. I actually worked before the internet.
What did you do? What did you do?
I was about a hardware engineer.
You should talk to Paul about this. So what did you do?
I actually slept better before the internet.
Did you?
Yeah, because you didn't get emails every 5 seconds.
Yeah.
Right?
Do you ever wake up in a panic in the middle of the night thinking that you need to like check your email?
Absolutely.
Yeah,
all the
time. I do the same thing.
Right.
I refer to that as the editor's nap, but I guess you might have a different name for it. The engineer's nap. It is kind of insane. It is insane.
Literally, you got to sleep better. Yeah. You actually could have a weekend. There was not this flow, rush of information like, oh, what do I need to buy now at 2 a.m?
Did you prefer it?
You know, sometimes you like to go back to those days.
You're dating yourself here if you say you prefer it.
I'm pretty
old. You just want to go out to the forest and, you know, chop some trees down. And I don't know. What did people do?
Did you do that? Back in the day, yeah. You could actually go
in
your garage and, like, saw some wood and build something.
So you weren't exactly in a garage, but you were at Apple a little while ago. And you were at Apple during, and we have a bunch of new stuff that we're going to talk about, but I want to talk about this a little bit. You were at Apple during a particularly exciting time. I mean, it's always exciting at Apple now.
Yeah, absolutely.
But they had some dark years, and they came out of the darkness, and you were there for like that portion, right?
Exactly.
Were you involved in the original iPod?
Absolutely.
You worked on that?
I presented the original model right to Steve.
Did you?
Yes.
You were like, here's what we should do.
I was a contractor for 6 weeks.
Was the wheel there?
I was a contractor for 6 weeks. I presented the business and the product, a styrofoam form. And in that meeting, we signed off on it and went ahead with it.
And you started working at Apple building that?
Yeah, just a few weeks later, I joined the company. And
so who's responsible for the wheel? Was it you?
So the responsible for the wheel was actually Phil Schiller.
Really?
Schiller, yeah.
Schiller was the man
who's very
the
smart
wheel.
Guy. Great guy.
He is a genius. Hates Instagram now, though, apparently. So you worked on the iPod. You worked on a bunch of iPods.
18 generations.
So iPod Nano?
Just about everyone.
iPod Touch.
iPod Touch, absolutely.
iPod Classic.
Shuffle. Classic. The video iPod, the photo
Nano.
iPod.
Nano. Is there a mini?
Nano, the mini.
Yeah. The fat mini? Was that the mini, the fat one?
Yeah. Oh, no, that was Fat Nano.
Oh, Nano, right.
Right,
Nano.
Exactly.
And then Nano got really skinny, right?
Exactly.
They're like, we're just kidding. It's
the only one I really didn't do was the one, the Touch Nano that's out now.
Oh, yeah. The one that, like, basically everybody wants to make into a watch.
Exactly.
But you also worked on the iPhone.
Yes, the first three generations.
So you were there for the inception, the creation of the original iPhone.
Absolutely.
And how did that go? Like, where did that come from? Was that, did Steve, run into the engineers? I don't know where he would run into. Did he run anywhere? Probably not. did he walk in somewhere and say,
He walked fast.
Yeah, I want to make this thing. Here's what it looks like. Or was it a group?
There was all kinds of different gestations of it. Actually, we did three different types of iPhones. There was a iPod plus phone, and then there was the iPhone, and then there was the next generation iPhone, and that's the one that actually shipped.
Did any have a keyboard?
None of them had
a
keyboard.
There was never a virtual keyboard. Yeah, but like there was never a version with like a QWERTY?
Never had one.
Really? Was it even discussed?
Well, it was definitely discussed. It was a heated topic.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely.
Were there people that were for it and people that were against it?
Absolutely.
Were you for it or against it?
I had known a lot about touchscreens, and given my 15 years at the time, and so I was skeptical. I wanted to try it first.
Oh, so you were like a hardware guy. You were like, let's do a hardware keyboard.
No, I was just, I want to try it. I wanted it to work because it made sense that you wanted a full screen. You didn't just want a little keyboard. The biggest problem with the iPod plus phone was that we had a little screen and we had this hardware wheel. And we were stuck with that.
So you were literally like
we were making
an iPod and you
iPod
were like making
phone.
Calls.
Exactly.
That seems like it would be kind of not intuitive.
Well, you could make the old dial wheel.
Well, yeah, no, I mean, like a perfect recreation of a phone that hasn't been made in 50 years.
Sometimes you have to try things to throw it away.
Yeah, right? and so you were there for the original iPhone, the 3G and the 3GS.
That's right.
And then you bailed. You're like, I hate making all these wonderful, successful products.
No, I actually...
And I hate all this money, Apple.
After the first year, I actually met my wife at Apple. And we were there for 9 years, and we were running and working so hard, and we had two little ones, a 1- and a 2-year-old.
Is that common? Is there a lot of romance on the Apple campus?
Yeah, a lot, actually.
A lot of hooking up?
Yeah, absolutely.
Real.
I have some interesting stories.
Real nasty stuff. Orgies. Orgies on the Apple campus.
I never heard of those, but maybe my wife did. She was head of HR.
You are in trouble right now, okay? And my apologies to your wife for such a... weird story. Anyhow, but so you left Apple in what year? Was 2000 and
Officially 2010.
Okay, so not that long ago. And then you were like, okay, I can finally make a thermostat. See, did you ever pitch a thermostat? Because did you ever go in there and say, guys, we got to build a thermostat?
No,
really?
I did not.
You were like, Steve.
I did not pitch a thermostat.
This is the next wave, man.
No.
Thermostat.
The first person I pitched was my wife, and she went, what?
She was like, I'm
the
leaving.
iPod guy, what?
Well, it's got a wheel, kind of.
It does.
You know?
Absolutely.
So, okay, so you went into business and you were like, I want to make a thermostat. What was the desire behind that? Like, where did that come from?
Well, really, I was with my wife designing a next generation home, a green home and a connected home, a fully connected home. We were starting this design before the iPhone came out and before the iPad came out. So I knew that those things were coming, and so I was saying, when you have a device in your hand all the time, your interface to the world, how does the world around you change?
Isn't that illegal if you know the product is coming to build a product based on...
It was just for me and my wife. And my
oh, family. You were like, I'm just going to build one.
Well, no, we were just building a house.
Oh, okay.
We were building a
okay,
house.
Okay, so you were like, the iPad is coming.
And we said, okay, how is this house going to change when you have this interface?
Right.
And so we went through every single system, lights and all these different things. And at the end of the day, I was... going, well, obviously you want to control your thermostat because this is in Lake Tahoe and you want to change it because it's very expensive to heat and cool the house.
Right.
And so I wanted to change it from anywhere. So I was looking all over the internet for something, couldn't find anything. And I just said,
they have like Wi-Fi, but they have Wi-Fi connected thermostats at Home Depot.
Have you tried them?
Honeywell makes a great Wi-Fi product.
Not that I know of,
great,
actually.
Tremendous. No, do they not?
Not that I know of.
I don't know. I'm not really, I honestly don't know that much about thermostats, I'll be honest with you. Before you came along, I never
thought
about, before Nest existed, I don't think anybody in our industry thought about thermostats. I mean, maybe if you had to replace one, you're like, uh-oh, better call someone to replace this thermostat.
Exactly. You did it maybe
this,
once
like,
every 20 years.
This thermostat on
every
my
20,
wall. I mean, ours are, you know, my house are like painted over. You can't even see the numbers on them. Isn't that, I feel like it's a common thing.
And most people forget that $1,500 a year is what you spend that thermostat controls. So you're like, why is something so underappreciated that costs so much money and uses so much energy?
So you said you were thinking about, you know, holding these devices and wanting to control them. Why not just make a box, a simple box, and have the control always be on an iPhone or a...
That's what a lot of people have said to me. And you know what I say? And they go, oh, why doesn't the cell phone just, you know, when you go away from your house, it just shuts the house down.
It's a great idea.
And then, you know, when you drive up, it turns on again. Well, typically the people you talk to who bring up those ideas, they don't have a family. They don't have kids. They don't have people who are in the house. So you're does everybody have to have a cell phone? How does this all work?
Right.
So you have to think about the interface.
You don't want the kids messing with the thermostat, though. That's always a disaster. They're going to turn it way up, turn it way down.
You got to teach them.
Rip it off the wall.
You got to teach them.
The Nest cannot be ripped off the wall, though, can it? It's actually, I don't know, maybe it can.
It
I can't afford one, and they were sold out when I tried to buy one. And it's been
but now we have one just
you have
for
them back
you.
In stock?
We have them in stock.
So let's talk about the Nest. Explain to me, it's got a circular control.
It's got a dial.
These guys probably know, but let's go through the steps. What does it do? Explain
well,
the Nest.
The Nest is simply a round dial. And 99.9% of the time, all you want to do is turn up or down the thermostat, right? You just want to make it cooler or warmer. So very simply, you just have a ring, and that's it. And
it's got a display on it.
And it's got a display on it. It's a color display. And it just gives you the current temperature, and it shows you the target temperature, and that's about it. It gives you a little leaf on it to show you when you've actually selected a temperature that's more energy efficient than you typically select.
And if you have more than one in your house, they can talk to each other?
They talk to each other, and you can control it anywhere in the world from an iPad, an iPhone, an Android phone.
Are they apps, or is it just like a...
It's an app, or there's a web browser app for Safari or Chrome or IE.
And so hardware startups are really hard. I mean, that's my understanding. It's very difficult to be
a
small company making hardware.
Hard to get them financed,
yeah.
And it's hard to find the talent because most of that hardware talent has moved offshore.
Right.
Most people don't design hardware.
So how does that work? I mean, how do you go from thinking of this thing to actually going and, I mean, you don't have to give me every step, but I mean, obviously you had to pitch this to people with money and say, I want to make a thermostat. Were people resistant to this idea? I mean, it seemed to me like people would go...
We got the money in less than 24 hours.
Really?
Yeah. Well, I've been in the Valley over 20 years. I've been doing hardware for over 25 years. I've been doing connected services for over 15 years. So basically, it's nice to have a hopefully a good track record.
Look,
behind
I made
you.
The freaking iPod, okay? Give me money and I'll deliver. So you did deliver. You sold a ton of these. How many? Do you know how many you've sold? I guess you would know how many you've sold.
We've sold a lot.
Can you share a number?
We are not sharing numbers, but we are breaking all of our targets were. We're busting through them.
People are freaking out over this thermostat.
We sold 5 months of inventory in 72 hours. In the first 5 months of inventory. We thought we were going to open the store 3 weeks later. We didn't open for five more months because we had so much demand.
That's
and now finally the store is open for all comers.
That is insane.
For a thermostat.
For a thermostat.
For a thermostat.
You must feel pretty good about
it. It's great. The first day when we actually had our launch party, we just invited a bunch of friends. We had 500 to 800 people celebrating a thermostat.
You now can, like do whatever you want to anybody and just remind them of how well the Nest sold, and they'll just let you do it. You can be like, I'm going to steal your car. I created the Nest. Get out of my face.
You know, we did a little
like,
bit.
I'm leaving dinner in the middle of dinner. I don't care what you say. I'm Tony Fadell. I made the Nest. Right? You do that? I would.
No, not really.
I'd like walk into people's houses and like knock a vase off a table and say, oh, you have a problem with that? Well, I created the Nest. Sold out in 72 hours.
Come get me.
What have you done? You don't do that?
Not really.
That'd be my first thing that I'd do as soon as I sold through. But you, so they're back in stock now.
They're in stock.
Yeah, so I can go buy one.
Yeah, you can go to Best Buy and buy one. You can go to nest.com to buy one.
And they're what,
$250?
$249.
$249.
I'm sorry.
And most of them are actually installed
by... Why not just sell them for $250?
Hmm?
Why not just say $250?
Well, it's not $249.99. It's $249.
Okay, it's a full dollar savings.
It's a full dollar.
It is a mental thing, though, isn't it? I mean, people really do... You know, there's like $199 is the sweet spot, $99 is the sweet spot, $249 is like, it's kind of premium, but it's not $250, is it?
But no, it's not $250.
Right. So you've attracted a lot of attention for Nest. The Nest, what do you call it?
We call it the Nest Learning Thermostat.
You really, every time you talk about it?
We call it the Nest.
It's kind of a mouthful, this learning thermostat piece. And it does learn. It
absolutely learns.
It sees your patterns, your habits, the temperatures of the house and...
Well, the first thing is 10% of thermostats installed. There's 250 million thermostats in the U.S. Only 10% of those are programmed to save any energy because it's so difficult to program.
Right.
And so, literally, when we now have data that shows all of our Nest customers actually, by learning, have 99% of them have schedules that they've actually saved energy.
Do you know how much energy they're saving, or kind of monetarily?
Yeah, we've seen anywhere between 10% and 60%. On average, it's about 20 to 25%. Because they literally just track your habits. When you wake up, you turn it to one temperature. When you go away, another temperature. When you go to sleep, a different temperature. So we just learn those patterns, and then we just play them back.
And then you share that data to Facebook. And someday your Nest will be like, check out this new Zynga game. Do you imagine
it's a perfect display for like playing Tempest.
No, I know. Remember Tempest. That would be amazing. You should do that.
Well, somebody should hack it.
Is there any opportunity of a game of Tempest on the Nest? Because that would be like, I'm buying one, no question. And then it would be like, oh, I got it. It's cold in here. And then
I'm taking like
20
a note.
Minutes later,
taking a note.
My wife would be like, what are you doing? level 18 in Tempest. Get out of my face. I do get stuck. Do you do this? I mean, are you a tinker? I get stuck doing things where I'm like, got to go do this. And I pick up a phone for a second, and then I'm just like,
yeah, you're lost.
Zone out for
you're
half
lost.
An hour.
Absolutely.
So anyhow, as I said, the Nest attracted a lot of attention. Some of it.
We're very happy.
A lot of it very positive.
Uh-oh, here it comes.
A lot of people excited about it.
Yes, very excited.
Some people.
Are heated.
Some people.
Forgive the pun.
Some people are getting worked up about it. A little hot under the collar.
Yes.
Honeywell, you've been sued by Honeywell?
Yes, we have.
For patent infringement?
Yes, seven patents.
Seven patents.
Seven patents.
And now Honeywell's been around for 1,000 years.
I was born.
Honeywell's been around a long time.
They have been.
And really, do you know a lot of companies that make thermostats? I mean, I have Honeywell thermostats in my house. I know there are other companies.
I'm sorry.
Well, they're painted over and they're old. And they've got the dial, and I can't see. I'm like, I guess it's on. So they're suing the crap out of you. How does that make you feel?
Validated.
Really validated?
Yeah. You know, look, we're new guys on the scene. We think we're doing something really important.
And they feel threatened?
It appears so.
Yeah.
It appears so because they didn't call us. They didn't say, hey, let's work this out man to man.
They didn't want to settle. They weren't like, you know what, we see you guys are doing some things that look similar. Maybe we can sit down.
Yeah, let's talk. You know,
they didn't want to do that.
They didn't want to do that.
They just wanted to publicly address it in the court of law.
Exactly.
And how do you think you're going to fare in this?
Well, we just issued our response, and actually you guys posted on the website.
We did post it.
Our 56-page, I think, response.
Did we post the whole response?
Yes.
We like to be thorough. And you know, Neil is a lawyer, so anything that's remotely legal, he's like starts salivating and you know, it's like he has to take his jacket off. He's like, I gotta go to work. He like clears his desk. That actually happens. You think I'm kidding. It's a little frightening. But you're gonna go to court on this over this.
Well, that's what they want to do. We'd rather not, but
right. But you think that you've got a chance to defend yourself and to win here?
When we looked at it, all seven patents, they were clearly invalid, and what we've said was baseless. And
did you say they're worse than a patent troll?
I have actually
said
worse
quote?
Than. Well, yeah. Let me describe why. If you look at
You're like, yeah, damn right I said
damn
it.
Damn right. I said they're worse than
I'm
a pet.
Tony Fadell. I created the nest.
Knock over a vase or
yeah,
two.
Just go for it.
No, literally, if you look at IP protection out there, you see things like Apple suing HTC. And that is all about innovation. But Apple's saying, let's play fair. And then you look at somebody like Microsoft, and you saw what they selling patents and all these other things. They treat it as a business. But once again, they're treating innovation as something that is good to have. We just want, they want to get paid for it. It's a business. If you look at, you know, even classic patent trolls, they want innovation to thrive and exist out there. And so why do they want that? Because they have some patents, they would like to get paid for theirs as well. In all three cases, they want innovation to thrive and be a great thing. In our case, these guys want to stay the status quo. They want to be number one, and they want to use basically crap patents against us to try to intimidate us, intimidate our market, intimidate our channel, and intimidate our customers.
They're not.
They do not want innovation to thrive.
They're not like, let's find a way to work this out.
No.
They're like, we're going to sue you out
of existence. They just threw it into court. They never called us.
Right.
So, to me, that
who
means.
Who would call you, the CEO? Is he a million years old?
No.
Hello?
I've never met him.
You use the rotary phone?
I've never met him.
It's Honeywell.
I wish he would have called me.
It's Honeywell, damn it. I don't know who that is.
He's actually not really old. Honeywell. He's actually Allied Signal.
Oh, of course.
He's Allied Signal. And he changed his name to Honeywell when he bought Honeywell.
You were talking about this backstage. That Honeywell was Honeywell, and then they were bought by a company called Allied Signal.
Correct.
Which, by the way, sounds like a totally nefarious. Like, you Allied Signal is not something you want to deal with. But then they became Honeywell.
Yeah, they moved their headquarters from Minneapolis over to New Jersey, and they
changed
the name.
Jersey? Are they in Jersey?
And they changed their name to Honeywell.
You're going to die, okay? I just want you to know.
Yes, they have some friends.
They're going to send guys to your house, and you're dead, man. It was wonderful knowing you. All right, so.
Jersey boys.
So you're going to go, you're going to fight this.
We have to.
Well, I know you have to.
We have to, and we have the best. We have the best in the business. We actually have the person who was next to me for getting basically sued at Apple every week. Chip Lutton, who joined the team, he was the head of the chief patent counsel at Apple, has now joined our team. He is now part of us. He has been advising us for a year.
Honeywell is going down. Apple doesn't screw around. And I'm sure this guy doesn't screw around.
Chip is awesome.
So I'm sure you've got a pretty good shot. Well, we're going to be tracking it, obviously. I mean, we're fans of innovation. I think this, I mean, you know, for our readers and even for the editors at the site, this patent stuff is like, it's almost, it just seems to be overtaking the industry. I mean, the fact that we're reporting, you know, 25%, 30% of our stuff now, I feel like we're reporting on people arguing about ideas, right? And it's a pretty crazy point in our industry. I mean, does it scare you? Do you feel like innovation is being stifled? I mean, it looks like innovation is being stifled.
I think that it is being stifled in the smaller companies. In the larger companies, what they're really doing is they're just fighting about market share and trying to make sure they either get paid or keep them out of the market or make them innovate differently. So it does put everybody on to think twice about what they're doing and how they're doing it. And it does enrich the lawyers. Absolutely enriches the lawyers.
Good time to be a lawyer.
It's a very good time to be, not just in Silicon, but anywhere, because you'll get sued in the court of Texas and the court of
Minnesota. Right. Well, I mean, yeah. But there are a lot of, there's a lot of Silicon Valley lawyers that are very active right now.
Absolutely. And, yeah. They're loving it.
And now you've got one.
We have a great set of lawyers. Absolutely.
Okay, so you're doing the thermostat. You're going to fight Honeywell. You're going to take Honeywell down. You're going to ruin Honeywell. I'm quoting you. Those are your words.
I didn't say that.
And I quote, we're going to put Honeywell in the ground, so help me. Tony Fadell, you said those words.
They're a very big company.
So what's after the thermostat? Is there something beyond the thermostat?
Well, right now we actually ship 2.0 of our software, and so we're continuing
Tempest.
Tempest, exactly. Actually, putting in more energy efficiency into the thermostat just via software upgrades that happen in the background. But next week, we're actually going to announce an energy report that comes with your thermostat. So each month, you get a kind of a history of what you've done and how you can save more that's personalized.
But it makes sense, though. You've got these things on the walls. They're connected. They can talk to each other. home automation is a place that seems like a likely area or a good area for you to go. Is that something you've considered? I mean, home automation to me, I have a new house. It's, I think all the time, like, God, I just wish there was some, like the Nest seems like this very self-contained, sensible, beautiful system for doing something that happens in the house that you don't think about that much. Is that a place you might go? I mean, there's a lot you can do in a house if you've got things talking to each other. Have you thought about that?
We think about it all the time. I have my R&D house that, you know, I go through, and a lot of times my wife doesn't like what I do to the house, but I automate it. So I learned through that.
What are you doing to the house?
Yes.
Disco.
I can't tell you. I'll give away too many things.
Strobe lights.
Turning beds.
Turning beds.
Yeah.
Boy, you're just in a lot of trouble tonight. That's something you'd consider?
We're looking at all the things, but frankly, you know, we're still small. We're still trying to get enough production out for everyone. We're still trying to get to other countries. Nests are in all 50 states. We've actually seen them light up in Canada, all across Europe, in Saudi Arabia, and Japan. So we're still just trying to...
So people are taking...
They're buying them in the states and then taking them all around the world. So we still just have to build our market.
There's just a huge appetite for this.
Huge.
For thermostats.
There's billions of thermostats.
Who could have possibly guessed this?
Well, when you look at it, thermostats, 10 million are sold a year in the U.S.
10 million Honeywell thermostats.
And
you're about to change that.
Yeah, oh, well, we hope
you are changing it. All right, Tony, thank you so much for joining us. Really appreciate it. Tony Fadell, everyone. And you have to come back either when you're in the thick of it with Honeywell. You probably won't be able to say anything then, but when you win, you come back and talk about it. Thanks so much, Tony.
Thank you.
Really appreciate
it.
My next guest probably doesn't need an introduction for you guys, but I just want to say that we're super excited to have him. He's part of the Vox family. He's about to launch an amazing new game site. Please welcome Chris Grant. Yes. Chris Grant, how are you?
Just right there.
I don't think we rehearsed that enough earlier.
The rehearsal was a lot longer.
A lot longer, a lot slower.
Yeah. Wasn't it?
Chris, thank you for joining us.
Thanks.
Thank you so much for being here.
Thanks for having me.
I don't know whose booze that is, but you're welcome to.
That's my booze.
Is that yours?
Yeah, no.
That's great.
Snuck it out here just a second.
Fantastic. So.
Hey.
Got a new website.
Polygon.
Well, it's not there yet. You don't have it yet.
No, it's not there.
So Chris is, as you guys may know, he's the editor-in-chief of formerly Vox Games, now Polygon, and got a crew of amazing, there's the logo, this awesome logo, which I'm really, I have a kind of in love with. How did you get this name? I mean, this is incredible.
So
Polygon.com.
Yeah, it's Polygon.com.
You would think that there would be no chance of anybody ever getting that.
We had to fight. I mean, so we had the team, like you said, and we got a bunch of editors together and thought what would make a great gaming site.
Yeah, an amazing team. I mean, this team is like, I mean, I know
it's a team.
You may not know all of these people by name, but you should. This is like such a super group of gaming journalists.
And we're still hiring.
Still hiring. Jobs, there's job postings on the site.
Job postings on the site, yep.
Yeah.
So we're talking about names. We come up with Polygon pretty early. I think it was actually Justin McElroy and I. And we start thinking about what other names if we can't get Polygon. So we start pursuing.
I was actually in one of these, you guys were having like Skype conversations with fantasy backgrounds and like a robot would go by. But you guys were having, in the office one day, you were having like a Skype conversation. You were like brainstorming.
Yeah, we brainstormed.
You had a lot of different ideas for names.
Yeah, so.
And you brought some slides.
Yeah, so we thought we'd share, if you guys didn't see it, we shared some of these at PAX. What some of our potential names?
Yeah, so these are just so you understand. There was a period where it didn't look like you could get Polygon.
We were
and you're like, we got to think of something else. Here are some. This could be the name.
Yeah.
And we're gonna take you on a walk through them. Here we go. So the first one, Ragdoll.
It's Ragdoll. Yeah. Ragdoll.
Is this an album cover? What is this?
No. So we did some concept art. You know, picked some of the names. We had
This is like Linkin Park. This is like,
it's edgy.
Limp Bizkit.
Limp Bizkit. Yeah, that's good.
Puddle of Mud.
And we thought Puddle of Mud fans like what? Dolls.
Yeah.
And so
like Insane Clown Posse. This is sort of Insane Clown Posse
style.
Yeah,
it's got some Juggalo going on.
Yeah. It's got a clown.
So
a ragdoll
club. It was ragdoll. It was going to be ragdoll.net, maybe, I don't know.
Super disturbing.
So the next
one. What was the thing? What was the thinking behind ragdoll? Like what?
We had a, I don't know, 200 names on a whiteboard.
Like it's a thing.
It's a thing
people
that exists.
With, people did play with it at one point.
Yeah.
Now it just terrifies
everyone. Ragdoll physics, right? In games, you got trials, you know, you floppy ragdoll.
All right, next slide.
Crepedia. We played a lot of.
I don't understand.
We played a lot of Super Crate Box. That's the only. That's,
is it, what is this? Is it an iOS game?
Yeah, it's an iOS game.
You were talking about it before. This looks really good. I've never played this.
Yeah.
All right, Cratepedia?
We weren't sure
it's
of the
like a Wikipedia for crates.
Yeah, and the whole site design, we pitched it to Bankoff at Vox Media, and he said, wait a second, you're going to make Wikipedia for one game? And we said, sorry for wasting your time, sir.
All right, what's the next one?
Gamernista. One of my favorites. It's edgy. You know, you're thinking like revolution. What's revolutionary?
And it's like you know, throwing a Molotov cocktail at the game industry.
Right. Yeah.
Just blow it up.
So like, what is like Sandinistas?
Burn gamers alive.
Yeah.
Huh?
So we would. I don't know. You have a theme. You know, you wear masks.
I like
and stuff.
The art you bought after this.
Yeah.
And great so font. Great use of a font.
Mocked
there.
Up some good stuff. There.
All right. What do we got? What's the next one?
Sprites. So I think you can see the branding opportunities.
Great
already.
Great branding opportunities. It's a short walk to paradise, really.
Yeah, and come check out sprites.com for the internet website, video games, also drink Sprite.
But does Sprite own sprites.com?
It's parked. These were all parked.
Let's find out.
So this was all.
Check it out, guys. I'm using it on the air. Are you happy now? Let's see who. Let's see, sprites.com.
Yeah, I think it was a great opportunity. To pursue, is it gonna have the girl going to college maybe?
Oh, it's like a park. Wow.
Yeah, there you go. She's checking the internet.
You guys see this?
That's how you know it's a good site. So I think we could have done little something better with it.
By the way, they want $1 million for this site.
Here's the crazy thing. Why doesn't Sprite buy it and make a new line of Sprite called Sprites and buy multiple Sprites?
Yes. All right, what's the next one?
Don't just buy one. Object. This is a personal favorite because it's like, what isn't an object? They're all objects.
It's an object.
Yeah.
I object. That's the problem with objects. Objection.
Phoenix Wright fan site. Think what? About it. Phoenix Wright. You know, the objection, no, you don't. Everyone else gets it, right? Yeah.
Okay. It's a tough flat lie.
Yeah.
All right.
They get it.
Next one.
Screenplay. This was mine.
I get it. You play on a screen.
Yeah. Yep. Also, yep. It's a thing that Ben Affleck and Matt
a little more
do.
Common use so to the thing that's you get used to make a movie.
It's tricky.
Yeah. All right. What else do we have?
Oh, this is good. Gamer team.
This one's confusing. I'm confused. That is a poster of The Libertine starring Johnny Depp.
Yeah, that's Libertine Johnny Depp.
And that is Ovaltine.
Yeah.
You tweet, but you've done some editing, some MS Paint.
Creative adjustment. Yeah. We couldn't determine
is it
what
about,
it was
is
closer
it,
to.
Is the site about, you know, crazy sex? Is it about a kid's drink? Or is it a combination of the two?
Oh, good point. So I think you're getting to the right point.
Yeah, okay.
You know those guys that wear diapers? The only way they can get it going?
You went there. You really, really went there.
I think it's good.
What else we have?
Mesh. Mesh.com. We have a picture of a guy in a mesh shirt. It could be girls.
It could be a woman.
You know, this is, it's unisex, it's just edgy.
Is it actually what mesh is? Is it like a mesh clothing site?
No, it's parked. These are all parked. These are all available. So you guys, we're giving you
these
ideas.
Well, they're available, you have to buy them.
Yeah, and no, they're not free.
So guys, or girls, mesh.com, that's out there. All right, what else do we have?
Think about it. This is a classic, AP Aragon. So
I don't understand.
We couldn't get a polygon. What other kinds of gons are there?
What is an AP Aragon?
You might know like dodecahedron, like that's not a gon. But so AP Aragon is an infinite polygon with like no ends, but it's countable. I don't know. It's a math
did you,
term.
Did you consider infinite polygon? Because that's not bad.
Oh, that's not bad. Huh? It's a lot of letters though. See, AP Aragon, nice and short, easy to spell.
Yeah, no, no, not actually either of those things. All right, what else? Right, what else do you have?
Entergainment. I think it's pretty good.
I like this. What is this branding? Is that the warp from the beginning of Star Trek when it zooms? I feel
the
like
guy
this is
from Mega 64. That's the Mega 64 guy.
No, but
right
what
there.
Is what's the yeah, background?
It's like a warp field. Yeah. Warp field.
Entergainment, easy to spell over the phone. E N T. All the letters sound the same.
Oh yeah.
G.
It's got some clever wordplay. Enter game.
Game.
You know, game mint. It sounds like entertainment. Get it?
No.
So you maybe didn't see that the first
terrible.
Time.
What else?
through, and this was actually
not, but Vox Games. This is
we
not
use
the,
Vox Games, but our unofficial mascot and potential URL, Panda Suplex. PandaSuplex.com. It's available.
What's incredible about Panda Suplex?
We had artwork made.
First
up.
Off, it's available. Oh, it wasn't taken
somehow.
But what's incredible about Panda Suplex is it's you did the art of it's the pandas doing the move.
Yeah. If you actually Google Panda Suplex, you find a lot of animated GIFs of pandas suplexing each other, which is amazing. I recommend you do it.
Really?
Yeah, no, I'm not even kidding. Here's the best part, though. That guy isn't suplexing the panda. Because you think panda, you're suplexing
the
panda.
Oh, you're doing a, yeah.
The panda's suplexing the guy.
No, I think of it as a move. The panda suplex.
Oh, the panda suplex. That's
like,
a good
so a panda could do it, or a human might learn how to do it from a panda.
From maybe being raised by pandas.
Raised by pandas. Hmm. How did you win all those wrestling matches? I learned the panda suplex.
Wow.
Yeah.
There's
missed
a
missed opportunity.
There's a touching fanfic here.
Is this done? Are we done?
I think that's it.
Is that it? So there's some other names. I think Polygon was ultimately a better
name. We have about 90 other ones.
So. You really? You have slides for all of them?
They're great.
That's wonderful. I wish I could have been there for the vetting process. I'm glad that I have this. Sorry, I'm just going to close that. A little too.
What, sprites?
A little too much. I had the lyrics to Ragdoll up, by the way. I wanted to. I'm not going to go through them now. I've got a busy opportunity.
Really
all right, so let's just talk a little bit about gaming news, and then we're going to do something very fun. You wanted to talk about the Steam Box.
Yeah.
We reported on this. This is Valve. We've heard creating some kind of console. And I talked to you when we had some info. I ran it by you. You're like, this kind of makes sense with what I've heard. Explain to me why or how Valve might want to create something.
Valve's been in the news a lot lately. There was, of course, the rumor that Tim Cook stopped by Valve HQ, which
is a huge lie.
Yeah, apparently it's just a giant lie. Gabe Newell said it never happened. But
they say no to it. They say that a lot of things aren't happening.
It's true. I don't know. Who knows? So this is a picture from Valve's website promoting Big Picture Mode, which they announced in February 2011. And the idea is heading to the living room or anywhere there's a big screen. The Steam soon to be released. This was 13 months ago. 14
yeah,
months.
This is over a year ago.
Offering simple, easy-to-read navigation design specifically for
so the idea is here, it's a Steam in your living room, like, you know, if you were playing it on your TV,
on your couch.
Console. But how does that work? You have a gigantic, like, gaming keyboard and, like, a 20-button mouse.
So they announced
on
this.
One of those, like, TV dinner things.
Yeah, on a tray
that's
that
a cool,
you put on your
that's
lap.
That's a cool move, by the way, I think.
Do you remember the Phantom lap board?
Good times. It's like vaporware.
So they actually released it.
Nobody cared.
Not the Phantom lap board. So this is on the website. They've been talking about Big Picture Mode for a while. And it stands to reason that they've talked to hardware manufacturers about helping this, because you're not going to hook up a giant water-cooled gaming PC to your television.
You're not.
Well, good point. Touche. Right over here on the side is actually a giant water-cooled
PC. You can't see it off?
Can't just pan over.
It's like as tall as the television.
It's got a lot of blue LEDs.
And just
it's
such a fan is so loud.
So they've been thinking about this a lot, how to get to the living room, and it stands to reason that they've been thinking about concept hardware. Similar to Intel builds an Ultrabook. They don't actually sell you an Ultrabook. Somebody else does, but
right.
Intel designs a spec.
And we were talking about this, and your thinking is like, if Valve's going to do it, it's going to be, you think, maybe a spec. Kind of, and we said this in our article, like Android, it'll be like, here's our stuff. Like, here's the system, basically. Go put it on your box. And you even, you know, we talked about Alienware. They made this, what is the name of it? Yeah.
X51.
The X51, which is looks like, you know, the Xbox and the PS3 made love to one another and gave birth to a large child. And it really does look like this hybrid of those two things, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But it looks like a console.
It's very clearly designed to be a console. It's got HDMI hookups. It's got slot-loading drive. I mean, you know, here Alienware is making a gaming console, and one has to assume that Alienware, being one of the biggest gaming PC manufacturers, that Valve has talked to them about Big Picture Mode.
Right.
You know, there's this idea that PC gaming will come to the TV, will come to the living room. And I think you're seeing Alienware's maybe a little early here. I'm assuming other PC companies have
something
gaming
like
boxes. And then when Steam Big Picture Mode's official, maybe it'll be an official Steam authorized.
So you think this might happen?
I think Valve is, I mean, it's already happening. You can go buy this right
well,
now.
Well, but Big Picture Mode's out. But something more of like an idea. Like, because they've also worked on gaming, like controllers and weird.
Yeah.
This here's one of their patents.
Yeah, they've got
this
patents.
This is like you can swap out different types of sticks and whatever.
So Valve's been thinking about this a lot. You know, how do you get PC gaming onto the console?
Right. I mean, they're obviously thinking about hardware. Why would they patent this?
I mean, and hardware is a big part. I don't think, here's the difference. I don't think Valve has any interest and making hardware on its
own. No, but they might have interest in designing
hardware. I think they very much want to define a spec.
Go make this thing.
Yep.
All right, so we're going to do something special now, now that we've had that conversation. You and I are going to do something special together. Can we get Paul and Neelai back out here? We're going to play a game. Have you ever heard of this game? It's called Johann Sebastian Joust. Has anybody ever heard of it? It really smattering. I don't even describe it as a smattering. No one's heard of it. It's played with, let's just talk about it. Let's get these guys out here. It's played with.
I don't perform for not applause.
Is there anybody in the audience who would like to play with us?
Yeah.
Let's just raise your hand.
Now you
if you'd
wish
like
you
to
clapped,
play.
Don't you?
This dude up here, yes, you raised your hand. You want to come down and play? All right, get down here. yeah. Okay, anybody else? We need one more person.
Over here.
Right here, we got a hand up. Yes, you.
Come here.
Yes. Come down here. No, wait, you're pointing down there? We only have one. You guys will trade off. Both of you, you come down here, and you. And you'll take a turn after the round is over. So here's the way the game is played. Let me explain. You want to come over here and set this up? It's played with Sony Move controllers. Here, hold on to that.
Okay,
hold on to that. You made. So let me just hand these out to people. There you are. It's like we're all having ice cream.
Oh,
you're getting nude.
He's about to. That's to do some serious.
All right, you're
going to
be in round two. As soon as somebody loses, you'll hand off. We'll hand off. So just kind of, you stay on the sideline here. Okay, so basically it is
played. This is weird. This whole part of this.
It's a Mac game. It's not out yet.
It's not released.
It's played with Sony Move controllers.
Tell them, not us.
And I'm telling everyone. You can hear me, right? You can hear me speaking? Okay, good. So the goal of the game is, let me try to explain this. Music plays, and it speeds up and slows down. And
jostle.
You're trying to jostle someone else's controller till it turns red and they get out of the game. And while trying to keep your controller very steady. And the faster the music goes, the more you can move it. The slower it goes, the less you can move it. And people get violent.
Turn your controller on.
And
there's no rules.
Oh, there we go.
Sure's on?
Yeah, hit the PlayStation. You got
okay.
it? Okay, is this ready to go? So, So we're going to play around here.
Oh, poor Chris.
What's happening? There we go. Chris, is yours not working?
Mine's on. Hold on.
Okay, you know what? We're not going to play. I was kidding.
Now try.
Okay.
Yeah.
So here we go. We're jousting.
I feel like I'm kind of in the middle here.
Don't
do
that.
Okay,
hand that over.
Hand it over.
No, you're trying to jostle my controller. Yes. Well, you're going to find out in a second. You're out, man. You're out, too. Hit the button and get back. What's this?
We're back.
No, we're not back.
What is this? Are you kidding me? You sat down? Oh! Let's do another round. We'll do one more round. I hope I don't need these. All right.
Oh, we're in the game.
Hit the button.
Turn it on.
Any button?
Press the trigger.
There you go. Oh, it didn't start yet.
Okay. Oh.
All right, here we go. We're on.
You're not in the game.
You knocked me out.
I didn't knock you out.
You gotta move it. Do you know jostle means? Oh! The editors. Oh! No! All right.
One more. Two out of three.
You want to do one more? I just really injured my knees. It's dramatic. Dramatic, no. All right, who's out of the game? Who wants to take this? Paul, you're out. No, Neelai, you're out. Here you go. I'll just observe. I won't do anything.
Okay.
I won't try to get revenge.
Sure.
Go right ahead. It's no problem.
Go away from me. Just go away.
You were waiting.
You jostled. You got jostled.
I don't like him.
No, just go for it.
Oh,
look at this.
Oh.
The Verge.
Bring the noise, internet boy.
Oh.
Come on. Come on.
Come to me. Come to me.
It's super weird, right?
Oh, well. There you have it. That is Johann Sebastian Joust. And it's awesome. Is it not?
It's the best, yeah.
Anyhow, Chris, thank you so much. And thanks to the audience members for coming up. And we'll be right back with Animal Style music. So stick around.
I use my phone all day, every day. Email, talk, directions, applications.
My phone's dead. My business is dead.
My phone battery starts blinking. Beep, beep, beep.
No, don't run out.
Boom, phone dies.
Really? Really?
So this phone lasts longer than any other phone?
I mean, this is sweet.
Feels really sleek. It's super thin. The 4G is so fast.
This is cool.
If I could use my phone all day, I'd definitely feel more powerful.
The all-day, all-night Droid Razor Max by Motorola. The longest talk time of any 4G smartphone. Now at Verizon.
Welcome back. Our next guest is apparently not food, might be prehistoric art, and is definitely music. Please welcome Animal Style. That was awesome. Thank you so much. Thanks. Animal style, everybody. That we now know what animal style actually sounds like. That's our show. I want to thank Tony Fadell, Chris Grant, Neli, and Paul, and you guys for coming. Thank you so much. We're going to hear one more song, and then we have some giveaways for everybody here. So thanks so much.